Attention today. Russian missile test panicked US military in Pacific Ocean. Officials later confirmed that the alarm was false and had gone off as Russia tested its ballistic missiles. Today, the Ramstein Air Base command post was notified via an alert notification system of a real-world missile launch in the European theater. The command post followed proper procedure and provided timely and accurate notifications to personnel in the Kaiserslautern military community, it said. The statement added that the missile launch was then assessed to be part of a training exercise and not a threat to the KMC area. The situation is all clear. Meanwhile, the Russian Defense Ministry, on Sunday, announced the success of the test launch of four Balava nuclear-tipped missiles from Vladimir Monomakh nuclear submarine that was conducted a day before in the Sea of Okhotsk, the Western Pacific Ocean. The dummy warheads hit their targets in the Arkhangelsk region in northwestern Russia, more than 3,400 miles away, the Russian Defense Ministry said in a statement, according to Associated Press. U.S. Strategic Command was able to quickly confirm the missiles posed no threat, so it is not clear why the warning was triggered. The report added, quoting an unnamed official, that such an incident is concerning because there is always a potential for miscalculation given tensions with Russia, although there was no indication of a threat this time. No U.S. aircraft or pilots were scrambled. The missile launch was determined to be part of a regional training exercise, and within minutes the control center again followed proper procedures and provided updated notifications. We consistently and routinely monitor for any threats to our forces and our allies, the statement from US Air Force Europe Army Africa said. Mikhail Khodorinok, a retired colonel from the Russian Armed Forces and a military commentator, called the US media reports as greatly exaggerated. He pointed out that Russia and the US give one another an advanced notice of at least 24 hours before every intercontinental ballistic missile test. He added that the procedure for doing so is specifically set out in an international treaty named the Memorandum of Understanding and was duly followed by Russia. During the exercises over the weekend, Russia followed this process and warned the US well in advance of the missile launches from submarines in the Sea of Okhotsk, off Russia's Pacific coast. He called the report unrealistic, emphasizing that the US early warning system does not simply detect the launch. Based on initial data, it also calculates the missile's trajectory, its flight time, and approximate target location, so would have determined them not to be a threat almost immediately. Meanwhile, in the event of some kind of major war between the United States and a great power rival such as Russia or China, wouldn't the deciding factor be determined by which country succeeds in dominating the skies to a large extent? Surely the need for air supremacy, one could argue, supersedes or would need to precede any kind of large-scale ground invasion. Certainly, ground power advocates will tell you that winning a war may ultimately rest upon the ability to seize, occupy and control territory, or at least the present, credible, realistic threat of a successful major ground invasion to deter further enemy action and declare victory. This may well be true, even if decisive or actual dominance were first established in the air. What these interwoven dynamics point to is that they fortify and depend upon one another. Complete victory in any major conflict, it would seem self-evident, would rest upon the ability to dominate or prevail both on the ground and in the air. Perhaps this is one reason why Pentagon war planners regularly say warfare is inherently joined, thus providing the conceptual basis for ongoing war games aimed at finding potential vulnerabilities or weak points likely to emerge in any kind of a major-scale war against a great power. While specifics related to these games are of course quite likely not available, some senior participants explain that the analyses need to be sure to fully accommodate an exploration of air power dominance, as air war would of course be of an entirely different character than that which was relied upon in Iraq and Afghanistan. While this reality is obvious to most and now well known, the Pentagon is making a special effort to ensure its advanced wargaming fully addresses the necessary multi-domain, air-ground-sea components expected to figure prominently in any future war. The U.S. working on having a better understanding of how to apply air power in a high-end environment is something he need to fight for. His memory has been focused on the low end. Only recently have we pivoted toward being able to deter a high-end adversary and change how use air power. Joint warfighting games help us expose the problem. Lieutenant General Joseph Gostella looking at weapons systems and how he elevate them to prepare for a high-end fight. Close air support for advancing infantry and precision-guided pinpoint strikes on enemy positions and fortifications were indispensable amid efforts to destroy Iraq insurgents, ISIS and the Taliban, yet there was no need for any kind of air-to-air engagement or destruction of advanced enemy air defenses. These things would be crucial in any war against a major adversary capable of projecting massive and destructive power from the sky. Dogfighting, aerial refueling for extended bombing runs and fighter pilot attacks and of course crucial intelligence data provided from space, not to mention space war, would all prove decisive in any kind of multi-domain, large-scale war. All of this is a big reason why the Army is making such rapid progress with its long-range precision fires programs. The ongoing and fast-moving series of initiatives, among many things, includes an effort to engineer new artillery weapons with twice the attack range, course-correcting ammunition, medium-range missiles able to destroy targets out to 500 kilometers, and even early work on a new cannon designed to hit 1,000-mile ranges. The advent of these kinds of ground attack advantages changes tactics for joint commanders, while at the same time, an ever-present need for air war-driven multi-domain warfare remains. Despite the growing importance of long-range ground fires, air attack will still be vital to any kind of success, Gostella explained, given the sheer number of targets likely to emerge in a major warfare effort. Airfields have to be defended. If you want air power and space power, you have to be able to defend it. The Air Force provides a fantastic opportunity with its bomber fleet and robust fighter fleet to offer a variety of long-range fires. We are developing technologies and missiles that can hold any target at risk, he added. These dynamics are likely one reason why both Air Force and Army leaders signed a joint, mutual service agreement to reinforce one another, support each other's domain and more successfully network weapons and attack platforms to one another in real time, thus enter joint all-domain command and control.